Jacksonville Jaguars. Protecting you and your family. Call 396-5555. Jacksonville. He's Hacker.
Talk about a fried egg. I lasted about 5 minutes out there. I said, to heck with this. I'll do this in the morning. And I don't have any inside information. The lady that did it, she got in there.
I mean,
she made it happen.
And he doesn't shy away from opinion.
And I do enjoy drinking cold beer at ballparks. So if that makes me a baseball fan, then I'm a diehard baseball fan.
It's Hacker After Dark on 1010XL.
And a very good Wednesday evening to you, Jacksonville. It is Hacker After Dark, 1010XL, 92.5 FM. A little after dark, before dark, up 6 to 8 today, tomorrow, and Friday, as Blue is in with Lauren Brooks and for the vacationing, Hayes Carline and Frank Frangie. We got a lot to get into, man. There is a ton going on in the world of sports. The National Football League will take center stage. We'll do a little NBA talk tonight as well. Drive safe out there. When I was driving in, felt like a nor'easter, man. It was windy out there, particularly in my little car. So hopefully you guys are getting home safe from work or wherever your destination is that you are headed. Guest lineup tonight looks like this. Steve Palazzolo of Pro Football Focus, PFF. You guys know I like the analytics, man. I didn't used to. Truthfully, I was not an analytics guy, but they've grown on me over the years, and Steve's one of the best at PFF, and we'll talk a little Jaguars, a little free agency recap, and a little AFC South with Steve Palazzolo. That comes up in about 20 minutes, a little under. Also, towards the top of the 7 o'clock hour, Luke Easterling of Athlon Sports, one of my favorite guys to talk draft with. We'll not only talk free agency, but how free agency affected what the Jaguars are going to do in the draft next month. We'll certainly spend time at the wide receiver position, which is a position everybody thinks the Jaguars will be highly invested in. Also defensive backs as well. So Steve Palazzolo of Pro Football Focus, Luke Easterling of Athlon Sports, both of those gentlemen join me in the next hour or so. Every night here on Hacker After Dark, we do kick it off with a big deal of the night and Dylan Denmark. Let's do that right now.
Time now for the big deal of the night.
What's the big deal?
What is the big deal?
No big deal.
It is a big deal.
On Hacker After Dark.
So something that I discovered on social media last night, and the conversation continued into this morning and this afternoon, and I found very interesting because I didn't know this. I had no idea this was the case or this was the opinion of some, but apparently it is the opinion of some. So let's dive in and let's discuss it. Let's talk about it. Apparently, at least in the fantasy football world and outside of that world, some other folks have chimed in. Apparently Trevor Lawrence sucks. Apparently he's no good. I didn't know that. I'm sure you probably didn't know that either. But there was a guy on social media that was comparing Trevor Lawrence and Caleb Williams, the projected number one pick in next month's draft. And, I mean, his name's Ryan. No, not me. It's another Ryan. I thought about getting this guy on, and then I thought better of it. I was like, maybe not. Maybe next week. He says Trevor Lawrence was viewed as a can't-miss quarterback. Caleb Williams is being viewed as a can't-miss quarterback. From what we know now, what says Williams won't be the next Lawrence? And to me, the connotation he was using is that Trevor Lawrence has been somewhat of a bust, somewhat of a disappointment. Boy, there's a lot to dissect there. I've been very hard on Trevor Lawrence, particularly at times last year. All you have to do is go back through my Twitter/X timeline. It will not be hard to find. But by no means do I think Trevor Lawrence is not the long-term answer here in Jacksonville. Far from it. By no means do I think Trevor Lawrence has been a bust. By no means do I think Trevor Lawrence has even been a disappointment. I think once you get to that word disappointment, you can start having a little bit more of a conversation, but that's only because of the expectations that were put on him. But there seems to be a narrative out there that Trevor's not any good. And I was stunned by this. Now, the guy that sent this out, admittedly, is a fantasy football guy. A couple of thousand followers, I believe, is what he has. But other people picked this up. Some agreed with him, some didn't. Obviously, the overwhelming majority of people that I follow and that I interact with did not, as I don't. I don't agree with his assessment. But if there is such a thing as Trevor being a disappointment, again, that's only because how can you live up to generational? And we've had that conversation. I mean, how are you supposed to live up to that? I don't even know what generational means. What does that mean? He can never throw a pick? He has to win 7 Super Bowls? Generational has not really been defined at the quarterback position. What were the expectations coming in? Trevor Lawrence in 3 years has thrown for 11,700 yards, 58 touchdowns, 39 interceptions, completing 64% of his passes on average. He's also run for almost 1,000 more yards and 11 more touchdowns. So 69 touchdowns, throwing and running for Trevor. Essentially 12,700 all-purpose yards in 3 years. You break that down, on average, Trevor Lawrence is averaging roughly, what is that, 23 touchdowns per year, throwing or passing combined, and over 4,000 all-purpose yards throwing and passing. That is not a guy that's not any good. That is not a guy that stinks. That is not a guy that's a bust. I do not agree with the assessment. Well, what if Caleb Williams' hype is like Trevor's hype and he turns out to be the next Trevor Lawrence? To me, that's a very negative connotation to what Trevor has done in 3 years. Can Trevor be better? Absolutely. I think he would even admit that. Do the Jaguars need Trevor to be better? Absolutely. I think you, the Jaguar fans, we in the Jaguar media would openly admit that. He has to be better. He needs to be better. But the Jaguars are darn lucky to have Trevor Lawrence. There are a lot of teams in the National Football League, a lot of teams, that would trade places with the Jaguars right now if it meant they could have Trevor Lawrence. Without question, there are a lot of teams that would trade places with Jacksonville. Again, I don't believe Trevor has lived up to the hype, but I believe the hype was unfair. I don't know and never have found out what generational is supposed to look like. Patrick Mahomes is probably generational. Maybe that's a good sample size. And no one's Patrick Mahomes right now other than Patrick Mahomes. So from that standpoint, yeah, maybe he hasn't lived up to the generational billing. But a guy that's compiled over 4,000 yards per year on average, running the ball and throwing the ball, a guy that scored on average 23 touchdowns per year, running the ball and passing, far from a bust, far from a guy that you do not want leading your team as a franchise quarterback. But there is no doubt, the end of last year, at least nationally, has people talking about Trevor Lawrence. And look, the reality is this. In the AFC right now, now the NFC is a separate story. The NFC, Trevor would be top 3 NFC quarterback right now. I don't think I'm stretching that. Tell me 3 more quarterbacks in the National Football Conference right now you'd rather have over Trevor Lawrence. But in the AFC, it's a different story. Patrick Mahomes, yeah, I'd take him over Trevor. Josh Allen, yeah, probably over Trevor. Joe Burrow, when healthy, yeah, I'm not breaking any news there. That's 3. Lamar Jackson, I mean, the guy was the MVP of the league. That's 4. And this is in your own conference, mind you. CJ Stroud? I laughed at that in the middle of last year. I'm not laughing now. I do think Trevor Lawrence and CJ Stroud are very comparable. I might lean Trevor, but that's one I would think about. I would take Trevor over Justin Herbert. I would. Sue me. He's beat him twice, including the playoffs, and Herbert's never been to a playoff game in 3 years. They're wasting Justin Herbert out there in L.A. Although, you know what? Having said that, if Jacksonville doesn't make the playoffs this year, you could make the argument that only two playoff games in 4 years did Jacksonville waste the rookie contract of Trevor Lawrence. That's why a lot goes into this 2024 campaign for the Jaguars. But Mahomes, Allen, Burrow, Jackson, I would take Trevor over Tua. I would take Trevor over Herbert. Obviously, you take Trevor over anybody New England has. Trevor and Aaron Rodgers, I mean, that's hard, right? Aaron's 39, going to be 40 years old coming off an Achilles. I'd rather have Trevor Lawrence. He's 16 years younger and doesn't have an Achilles. But when these quarterback rankings come out, these projections come out, these prognostications come out, particularly among AFC quarterbacks, Trevor will be fifth or sixth, no question. And it's hard to argue that. And because he was taken number one, because he had all the generational talk, when these national people, like the dude last night, is using a negative tone and talking about Trevor, we can defend him, and I think there is room to defend him, but it's a little bit difficult. It is a little bit difficult. Bottom line, I think the Jaguars are lucky to have Trevor Lawrence. I'm happy Trevor Lawrence is here. I think he is the franchise guy. But he does have to answer some questions. He's got to do better with turnovers. In fact, Doug Peterson earlier today on SiriusXM was talking about Trevor and about the decision-making, right? I mean, there were some times last year, particularly the Baltimore game at the end of the half. I mean, just mind-blowing things that Trevor did. You got to clean up the decision-making. Doug Peterson talked about that earlier today.
He's a tremendous player, and you know, you've heard that phrase, you know, big-time players make big plays in big moments. Well, that's where he needs to get to now. We as a staff have to get him there, and it comes down with his work ethic, which is for us second to none. I mean, he comes in, he works extremely hard in the off season. He's a full participant in the off season, and to me, that's so important to have your starting quarterback, the face of your franchise, in the off season program, throw into some of these young receivers, and getting these guys going early, and just being able to take that next step.
Yeah, look, I mean, the bottom line, Trevor Lawrence, maybe this will put a chip on his shoulder. A lot of negative talk about Trevor this offseason. Hey, whatever works, man. Doug Peterson said earlier this week he hasn't gotten over the collapse. He's going to use that as motivation, use that as fuel. I'm all for it. Maybe Trevor will use some of the disrespect nationally as fuel, as a little chip on his shoulder. We know Trevor does have chips on his shoulder, right? He'll go on social media and the notes emoji that he sent out one night, and I mean, he takes note of what people are saying. There's no doubt about that. And nationally, what people are saying is that Trevor is not a top five, dare I say a top six or even top seven quarterback in his own conference. I don't personally agree with that, but that is the narrative coming into the 2024 season. At the end of the day, the Jaguars, to me, are lucky to have Trevor Lawrence. I'm happy he's here. He's a franchise quarterback. But he needs to play better. And I get the feeling, the vibe, maybe this is my ultra positivity in my old age of 40, that he will play considerably better in 2024 than he did certainly at the end of 2023. 641-1010 on the text line, designed by Lifetime Enclosures. Your thoughts are welcome. Hacker After Dark, Before Dark tonight in for Rick Ballew. Coming up next, let's talk a little Trevor Lawrence. Let's talk a little analytics, Jaguar free agency, what has happened in the last couple of weeks. Steve Palazzolo does a great job for Pro Football Focus, PFF, and he joins me next. Hacker After Dark on a Wednesday evening in Jacksonville, Florida. And we're glad you're with us right here on 1010XL and on 92.5 FM.
Dan Hicken and Jeff Prosser.
Do you know how hard it is to find a decent man in this town?
We're men!
The Drill.
We are men!
Weekday mornings on 1010XL.
We are men! We are
Jacksonville men. Sports Radio.
Hacker here for Awaken 180 Weight Loss. Let me say it again. Awaken 180 Weight Loss. That is the company. That is the program that is changing my life. 35 plus pounds down in just over a month. I started on February 20th. February 20th, 36 days ago. I've essentially lost over a pound a day on Awaken 180. My coach, Kate, we meet every week. We make a game plan. I eat the food she directs me to. I stay away from things that I'm not supposed to. If you follow their blueprint, you will lose weight. I've done a lot of these programs in the past. I have never seen results like this. Do yourself a favor. Go to awaken180weightloss.com. That's awaken180weightloss.com or call 844-346-1800. That's 844-346-1800 and get involved with Awaken 180 Weight Loss.
Save big at Key Buick GMC with up to $12,500 off all new Buick Enclaves, up to $12,250 off all new Buick Envisions. Receive low APR rates like 1.9% for 60 months on select Buicks, or receive 4.9% for up to 48 or 60 months and 5.9% for up to 72 months. Come see the new 2024 Buick Envista in stock and ready to deliver. Key Buick GMC, across the street from Tinseltown, south side of Gate.
Ackerman Cancer Center now offers total body MRI, the latest industry-leading technology. Just one non-invasive scan provides a complete picture of your health to detect and monitor cancer with precision at AckermanCancerCenter.com.
Jimerson Burr is a full-service, Florida-based commercial law firm that has experience and capabilities to handle any legal issue a business is confronted with. Learn more about what they can do for you at JimersonFirm.com.
Any action?
Find more fish on the Ring Power Fishing Forecast Show.
That's a big redfish, guys.
With Captain Kevin Faber.
Oh, my gosh.
Brought to you by Awaken 180 Weight Loss.
Thursday nights at 6.
On 1010XL AM.
This is Dr. George Bari inviting you to look online at BariOrthopedics.com for the latest in medical advancements when it comes to getting you back to full joint health. After studying under Dr. James Andrews, I know proper diagnosis is the first key to treatment, and educating the patient is the fastest path to recovery. Whether it's chronic back pain, nagging arthritis, or necessary joint replacement, we're here to serve you in the best possible way. We are Bari Orthopedics, and online at BariOrthopedics.com.
Find out more at BariOrthopedics.com. That's B-A-H-R-I orthopedics.com.
Roland, 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 we're all calling Roland. The toilet's overflowing over.
When you've got a leak and can't wait a week, call Roland Reese Plumbing, 260-7059.
Certainly facing challenging economic times, I can't speak for all of us, but for me, comforting to know my money is in good hands with ITP Partners. Take it here for ITP Partners. Jacksonville guys taking care of my Jacksonville money. I'll admit it, I don't understand a ton about the economy, higher interest rates, 401ks, but I do know as I move closer to retirement, I continue to watch my money grow. Thanks to Chris Bryan, Jeff Hartman, Reagan Wright, Dan Abel, and Reed Wingate. Get in the game, guys. ITP Partners, always there to help. For more info, Chris at ITPPartners.com or call 904-312-9751.
American Electrical is looking for bright minds and hard workers to help light up North Florida. This community continues to grow, and now you can grow your career with a company that will make sure you succeed through commitment. American Electrical even has its own academy dedicated to training select students the electrical trade, and the best news, it's free of charge. Log on to American-Electrical.com to find out more. They're leading the way in electrical contractors on the First Coast. American-Electrical.com.
Let's fire up the flavor and ignite those appetites. Let's slow down and smell the barbecue. Because all your favorites are smoked for hours and ready for eating when you are. From our famous ribs to slow smoked pork. Enjoy some perfection by the plateful, safely in our dining room or in the comfort of your home. With curbside pickup, drive-through, and delivery. Sonny's Barbecue, local pitmasters since 68.
Jumbo Shrimp Baseball presented by FIS with tickets starting at just $5 returns this month to 1-2-1 Financial Ballpark. Opening weekend is set for March 29th through the 31st. Come early for the opening day street carnival and stay for the fireworks. Tickets for all 75 home games are on sale now. JackShrimp.com, Jumbo Shrimp Baseball, affordable, family fun.
Chose C for CSS Fireplaces and Outdoor Living. They can transform your backyard with fire pits, pergolas, screen enclosures, and outdoor kitchens. And CSS handles the entire project from start to finish. You dream it, they build it. CSSOutdoor.com.
1010XL is presented by Farrah & Farrah, exclusive injury law firm of the Jacksonville Jaguars. Protecting you and your family. Call 396-5555, Jacksonville. Let's ring up another guest on the All-Pro Roofing phone line.
Back here on 1010XL at 92.5 FM in the city of Jacksonville, we are glad you are with us. Boy, it's been a very interesting two-week period here in Jacksonville. Guys getting released, guys getting retained, and a lot of free agents brought in, and of course, one notable free agent that is no longer here. Let's talk about all of it with Steve Palazzolo of Pro Football Focus, PFF. We always love the folks over at PFF, and Steve's always kind enough to join us here on 1010XL in Jacksonville. Steve, how you doing?
Doing great. Thanks for having me again.
Hey, Steve, always appreciate the time, man. All right, before we look at it individually, just your thoughts in totality, what the Jacksonville Jaguars did, or maybe in some instances did not, over the last 2 weeks here in free agency.
Yeah, I imagine it's probably more uncomfortable than it is comfortable for Jags fans at the moment. I think, you know, when I look at the offseason, it's not always about, you know, every move being the perfect move to build the roster. But I think overall you want to make sure that in free agency, first, second, and third wave of free agency, you're filling your needs so you can get into the draft with just no holes on the roster, at least not in the starting 22, so you could draft the best players, look forward. And I think the Jags, again, there'll be some discomfort with no Calvin Ridley, you know, some question marks around Gabe Davis at receiver. I do love what they did with Eric Armstead. We could talk about all those for sure, but I think there's probably a little bit of angst, you know, going in with a few more question marks, I think, top to bottom on the roster maybe than when they came in.
Certainly the biggest story is, let's begin there, Calvin Ridley gone. He goes to Tennessee. They paid him a lot of money, Steve, no question about that. And he even alluded to that last week when he was introduced in Nashville, that money, you know, was nice of what he got from the Titans. So he's gone. Gabe Davis comes in. He's not even 25 years old yet, which is shocking to me. He turns 25 next month. He brings his 27 career touchdowns down here to Duval County. What do you make of Gabe Davis now being on the Jaguars?
Yeah, I mean, I think Davis is it's funny because he's one of those guys that's either over or underrated, depending on your perspective. I think because he had that incredible playoff game against the Chiefs where he had four touchdowns, I think it was just his second year in the league, right? I mean, everybody expected this, you know, massive step forward in years three and four, and he never really got that from Gabe Davis. But if you look at it, you know, from a high level as a fourth-round pick, very productive player and a guy that could become a deep threat, vertical threat. And I think that's, you know, extremely valuable, obviously, in today's NFL, being able to stretch the field. So I think the goal there is to kind of get him back on track. You know, I think you see this a lot with receivers where they fit with specific roles. And I think that's where Gabe Davis is more of that vertical threat, not the guy that's going to be necessarily a high volume. I don't think he's a true wide receiver one. I think there's really only 15 or 20 of those guys anyway. So, yeah, as long as expectations are set there, let that guy stretch the field, give Trevor Lawrence a guy to create chunk plays with.
The Jaguars received a pretty good amount of criticism 2 years ago when they brought Christian Kirk in. All the talk, he's never been a 1,000-yard receiver. Kirk has come in here and flourished when he's been healthy. Gabe Davis, do you see something similar? Could lightning strike twice now that maybe he's out from behind Stephon Diggs?
I think there's elements of that. You know, similar to Kirk, you know, I think when Kirk's done his best work, you're moving him around, he's in the slot, he's outside, handles, you know, gets a little bunch of the scheme plays from that offense. And it is all about playing the strengths, you know, and I think, you know, they do complement each other well, Christian Kirk and Gabe Davis. And to me, building a receiving core is all about having different answers, different options for what defenses are going to throw at you. Not necessarily just having a true wide receiver one, but having different styles and types. And that's where I think Christian Kirk, Gabe Davis, they're going to, you know, with Zay Jones in there as well, with Evan Ingram at tight end, you have different types of players, different styles. And, you know, week to week, I think it's going to be, at this point. You know what you're getting, whether it was in Kansas City or in Buffalo. He's been a very good player. And, you know, again, a solid presence and a big presence at center. I think a lot of teams are trying to make sure that they have size at center these days with, you know, how explosive some of the nose tackles are, but how big some of the nose tackles are as well. And, you know, Morris definitely brings that to the table.
Steve, there's no doubt the Jaguar offensive line struggled at times last year. Trevor was banged up quite a bit. If the starting offensive line on opening day is as it appears, Cam Robinson, Ezra Cleveland, Mitch Morse, Brandon Sheriff, Anton Harrison, is that an offensive line you can win with, in your opinion?
I think it is. Now, the way I look at offensive lines is, you know, just don't be bad, right? Just don't be awful. And so, you know, from a pass protection standpoint, I think it's solid. You know, Cam Robinson, I think, has gotten better through the years. That tends to happen with offensive linemen. I thought he was off to a very slow start his first 3 or 4 years, but he's improved. You're hoping for the same from Antoine Harrison in year two. Again, offensive linemen usually take a few years. Not many of them actually hit the ground running and become very good players right away. They sometimes take a year or 3 or 4. So you kind of hope that Harrison will accelerate that. And then on the other end, you kind of hope Brandon Sheriff isn't too far on the downswing of his career. But I like Ezra Cleveland. I think he's been a solid player throughout the majority of his career. But it's one of those offensive lines where when I look at it on paper, they're about middle of the pack type of offensive line. They're an average type of offensive line, which on paper I think is good. It's fine. You can win with that. But they also, if they all hit the wrong side of variance, as we say, as the nerds would say, if they hit the, you know, the bottom end of their range of outcomes, it could be ugly again. So it's always good to add depth and, you know, try to fortify it even more.
And what's interesting, Walker Little and Luke Fortner, are two guys that have played a lot of football, are now backups on this offensive line in the event some injuries do pile up. Steve, the biggest splash Jacksonville made, you alluded to him earlier, Eric Armstead, 24 hours after they lost Ridley, they bring in Armstead from San Francisco. We've talked about his relationship with Trent Baalke, who drafted him with the 49ers. What did you make of Eric Armstead coming to the Jaguars?
I really like this move quite a bit. I mean, I think there's multiple reasons for it. I mean, we chatted last year a bunch, and by our numbers at PFF and everything I saw on film, it was Josh Allen and friends last year rushing the passer. I mean, Josh Allen was an excellent pass rusher, one of the league's best, and they were not getting any production elsewhere on that defensive line, including from Trayvon Walker. I know Walker's played a lot of snaps, but I don't think he's been a force as a pass rusher, certainly not what they expected at number one overall. So adding Eric Armstead, I think, adds a couple things. First off, a really productive player, guy that can still play, but I love the ability of Armstead to move around the formation. He could play on the interior. He could play on the edge. He's a mismatch creator because of his length and his size. But he's also quick enough to rush off the edge, and he did all of that in San Francisco. And I think that actually helps Trayvon Walker quite a bit because now you have two really difficult, at least from a physical standpoint, two difficult players to match up with. And I know Trayvon Walker's had some success rushing on the interior versus the edge. Now you can mix and match with Allen, with Armstead, with Walker, move those guys around, create mismatches. We see this around the league quite a bit. The Chiefs have done a great job with that, moving Chris Jones, moving some of their length, their longer players, and just creating mismatches on the defensive line. So I think Armstead adds a lot of that flexibility. Your indicator, though, it's the pressures, it's the quick pressures, the quick wins. Those are the types of things that are not only impactful for the team, but also better and predictive of, you know, future high sack totals and future big impact plays. So I think Walker still has a ways to go from a pass rush perspective. And to me, I think the sack totals are a little bit of fool's gold because the PFF grade was still at 58. And that is a much more consistent number year to year. PFF pass rush grade is a much better indicator of what's happening in the future rather than sack totals. And I think, you know, that was similar to where Walker was as a rookie. So I think he needs to see a big jump in year three.
Couple of more for Steve Palazzolo of Pro Football Focus. Steve, on the defensive side, Darius Williams, Rayshon Jenkins, Kalavon Chaisson out, Darnell Savage, Ronald Darby, Trevis Gibson in. Is that a push, in your opinion? Do you have a thought one way or the other there, the guys that left compared to the guys that replaced them?
Yeah, probably a push overall. You know, Ronald Darby's an interesting player. He's been kind of like a rent-a-corner over the last couple of years, but he's a good player. He can still play when he's out there and healthy. Darnell Savage has had some ups and downs at safety. I think overall he's got great potential. Always needed to tidy up his tackling and just be a little bit more consistent. Trevis Gibson's definitely an interesting player. Again, just adding some depth there. I thought Caleb Von Chason, you know, just kind of an athletic projection coming out as a first rounder and never productive enough at LSU. And we saw that, never developed. And Gibson is a really, I mean, if you put Travis Gibson now as edge four, basically, on that team, that's a good spot to be, or edge four or five competing for that. So that's nice depth. Interesting to see how the secondary ends up working together, but Darby and Savage, I think on paper, are good solid players.
Talking to people in Baltimore, Devin Duvernay, we know about his return capabilities, former All-Pro, former Pro Bowler. Jamal Agnew was very similar here in Jacksonville, but Agnew was a former DB that converted to wide receiver. Duvernay has been a wideout his entire career. So to me, Steve, and I'm curious your thoughts, do they just basically get a younger Agnew that's more capable at wide receiver with Devin Duvernay?
It'd be tough for Duvernay to get the same type of attention that Agnew got. It was like every time he was on the field, you know, they were dialing something up for him, which was, you know, a little boom or bust, but a lot of big plays from Jamal Agnew. I would say Duvernay is a little bit more lateral than Agnew. I think Agnew had that ability to get behind the defense, take it to the house. Again, I know Duvernay had that punt return and everything. A little bit more of an agility type of player, get him some jet sweeps, get the ball in his hands in space, and he can absolutely make plays. So, yeah, I think every offense to me is your wide receivers four and five. You want a jet sweep guy, as I say, and, you know, pretty much a deep threat. And I think Duvernay has a chance to be that jet sweep underneath, you know, lateral agility type of guy. And, you know, he's been a good player for Baltimore.
Jaguars also brought in Joey Sly at kicker and, of course, Mac Jones to back up Trevor Lawrence. Steve, as we begin to wrap up, the Jaguar season ended 2.5 months ago. There's been a lot of change. They've brought in, what, 9 or 10 guys that will be a part of the 53-man roster. I mean, 20% of the roster has already changed, and we haven't even gotten to the draft in late April yet. Are they better than they were January 7th when their season ended, or are they about the same? What's your thought there?
It's funny. All the players that they brought in, I think, you know, I think Armstead is the safest one to predict production from. And then it can go either way for a bunch of the others. So, you know, like Mitch Morse, I think, again, he'll be consistent and solid. But Gabe Davis, a little, you know, boom or bust, high ceiling type of player. So I think overall it's probably a push. And it to me, it feels like Jacksonville, one of those years they have to hit in the draft. And that becomes, we see teams, you know, hit on 2, 3, 4 draft picks, guys who can immediately contribute. If they can do that, especially with Trevor Lawrence getting paid very, very shortly, I think that's just, it's just a huge draft for the Jags, because I like the guys that they brought in, but have to get that young nucleus built, I think, a little bit better in Jacksonville. So big draft for them. And overall, I'd say, yeah, close to a push, I think, at this point heading into the draft.
Steve, final question. The South, man, the AFC South was probably the most boring, predictable division in football 12 months ago. All of a sudden, you look now, excitement in Tennessee, bringing in Calvin Ridley, new coaching staff. Jacksonville's doing a lot. Houston with Joe Mixon and Danielle Hunter. Indy kept a lot of their own, but they get Anthony Richardson back. All of a sudden, the AFC South, a lot of intrigue coming into 2024.
Oh, I can't wait to watch the AFC South next year. Absolutely. It's going to be exciting. I mean, got to love what Houston's doing. I mean, I know, other than in Jacksonville.
Yeah.
But Houston's doing a really nice job, right? You've got the first contract quarterback. They're getting their players in. You know, Danielle Hunter is a D'Amico Ryan's type of defensive lineman. So they're building great depth and taking advantage of the rookie contract quarterback with Stroud. Fascinating moves in Tennessee. A little bit more aggressive, I think, than maybe people expected for a team that felt like they were in transition. And you mentioned with the Colts, with Anthony Richardson coming back, who knows? I mean, he showed a lot of flashes before he got hurt. So if he gets back on track, already made the playoffs last year. Colts look like another tough team. So, yeah, it's going to be a pretty fun division this year, I believe.
Steve Palazzolo of PFF. Steve, tell the good folks here in Jacksonville what you have coming out there at PFF.com in the coming days and weeks.
Well, I think the biggest thing is the PFF NFL podcast. We like to go do a lot of mock drafts, like to go team by team, breaking down what's been done and what teams can do. So I would search the PFF NFL podcast wherever you get your podcast.
Steve, I know you're very busy, man. Thank you for making time for us here in Jacksonville. As always, brother, we certainly appreciate it.
Yep, you got it. Appreciate you having me.
There you go. Steve Palazzolo of PFF here with us on 1010XL in Jacksonville. And, yeah, the AFC South has been completely transformed, right? Not only Calvin Ridley, but you look at what Tennessee did with L'Jarius Sneed. Boy, they gave him a ton of money, too. Between Ridley and Sneed, that's $105 million guaranteed to those two guys that Tennessee has given out. They signed Lloyd Cushenberry, the center from Denver, to a big deal. Kenneth Murray, the linebacker from the Chargers. The Titans had money. They spent it. Houston had money, and they spent it, bringing in Daniil Hunter, getting Joe Mixon for basically a can of Spam is what they traded for him from Cincinnati. And again, Indy didn't really bring anybody in, but they kept Michael Pittman Jr., right? They kept Grover Stewart, the big D tackle. They kept Kenny Moore at safety. They get Anthony Richardson back. So you could legitimately argue the AFC South, worst, most boring division in football in August. Here we are now, 7 months later, one of the most interesting divisions heading in to 2024. More on the Jaguars, more on the draft, more on the National Football League. A little less than 20 minutes. Luke Easterling of Athlon Sports will stop by. Coming up next, we haven't talked about this in a while. Spring football. No, not the XFL and that deal that starts this weekend, although I guess I'll watch some of that. No. Year three for Billy Napier at the University of Florida. The Orange and Blue game is 2 weeks from Saturday. Let's talk a little Florida, and let's talk about ridiculously low expectations from the outside world when you look at Gainesville. That's next on Hacker After Dark.
Need more Gators?
We've got you covered.
Search 1010XL Florida Gators
where you find podcasts,
or visit 1010XL.com to hear Hicken and Franchi on Mondays and Denny Thompson and Hacker on Wednesdays.
New episodes each week.
Here's Linda Beaver.
Did you hear what's happening? Beaver Toyota and Beaver Chevrolet are spring cleaning. New inventory on the ground means we need to make more room. Take advantage of huge savings on thousands of vehicles priced to sell. New and pre-owned prices have been reduced, and all sales associates have been instructed to give maximum value on all trades. But you better hurry. The best deals go first. Head to Beaver Toyota in St. Augustine
or Beaver Chevrolet in Jacksonville to take advantage of our spring cleaning sale.
We're here to wow you.
Are you 18 years or older, just got married, just got divorced, or have children? Listen up. Have you done your last will and estate planning? If you have questions, call Matt Hinson with the Hinson Law Firm. Reach him at 527-1700, offices Jacksonville, Florida. And don't let the state decide your fate.
Race into Gate for big offers. By big, we mean great deals on Red Bull and a chance to win tickets to the big race coming to Miami May 3rd through 5th. Buy 2 8.4-ounce cans of Red Bull, get one free. And if you're a MyGate Rewards member, you are automatically entered for a chance to win race tickets. Not a member? Download the Gate app and sign up today. See store for details. Go from good to Gate.
At Duck Duck Rooter, we understand plumbing issues can be a real inconvenience for your building or business, and we're here to help. We can handle all kinds of plumbing jobs, including broken pipes, clogged drains, line jetting, installing water heaters, and full repipes. Need a camera inspection or a smoke test? Yes, Duck Duck Rooter does that too. Plus, our lift station services include inspections, monitoring, cleaning, and repairs. When you're stuck, call the Duck. 904-862-6769. That's 904-862-6769.
This date in sports history is brought to you by Southeast Orthopedic Specialists.
On March 27, 1994, at the Players' Championship at TPC Sawgrass, Greg Norman set scoring record of 24 under to finish 4 strokes ahead of Fuzzy Zoeller.
When you think about a metal roof, think Prime Roofing. Prime Roofing is Jacksonville's local contractor that manufactures, fabricates, and installs metal roofs. Schedule today at PrimeRoofingFL.com. That's PrimeRoofingFL.com.
Hey, sports fans, this is Hayes Carlion from MyBookie. If you're still in the hunt for a sports book to call home, bet the nonstop action of the madness with MyBookie. MyBookie is a one-stop shop for all your sports betting and casino needs, complete with a real-life Vegas experience right from the comfort of your phone. Take your viewing experience to the next level with real-time live betting that lets you stream and bet the games right from the MyBookie website. Sign up now and take advantage of a generous welcome bonus on your first deposit all the way up to $1,000. Put in $200, get $300 ready to play instantly using promo code 1010XL. And the fun doesn't stop there. You'll get up-to-the-minute odds, props, and this week's expert predictions to help you decide who to put your money on. the best part about MyBookie, you can bet on anything, anytime, from anywhere. Use promo code 1010XL to secure your welcome bonus today, only with MyBookie.
Imagine waking up this time next week and being 100% debt-free. No credit cards, no car loan, no personal loan. Hey, it's Prosser here, and Loan Pronto's Equity Express line of credit can make that happen. Homeowners are turning their home equity into cash almost instantly. With Loan Pronto's AI-based system, you can get approval in about 10 minutes with almost no documentation, no appraisal, and no hassle. You can get hundreds of thousands of dollars out of your home. Use that money to pay off all your other loans. The average homeowner saves over $850 a month doing this. Listen, your home value's way up. You can use that to wipe out all those credit cards, get some money for a home improvement. Literally, hundreds of thousands are at your fingertips, and approval is just minutes away. So call now, 904-999-1508. 904-999-1508. That's loanpronto.com at 904-999-1508. NMLS 1661781, subject to lender approval, equal housing lender.
It's the Guggen Open.
Let's play some golf.
Listen to the drill for your chance to play in this year's Coastal Equipment Guggen Open.
Hey, so where do we tee off?
April 15th at Hidden Hills Golf Club.
Four.
Breakfast provided by Chick-fil-A. Enjoy a box lunch from Dandy Foods. Pick up a cigar from Tobacco Cove.
You can do this.
Win great prizes on the course from Edwin Watts Golf.
Thanks to our sponsors.
Andy's Automotive. CSS Outdoor. The Plumbers and Pipe Fitters Union 234. Royal Pest Control and Injury Care Centers.
Southeast Orthopedic Specialist is now offering ortho walk-in appointments. If you have an immediate need for orthopedic care, contact Southeast Orthopedic Specialist immediately. Avoid ERs and urgent care waiting rooms. For more information, go to se-ortho.com.
Relieve pain and get back to life.
SOS.
Southeast Orthopedic Specialist.
1010XL is presented by Farrah & Farrah, exclusive injury law firm of the Jacksonville Jaguars. Protecting you and your family. Call 396-5555. Jacksonville. Hacker After Dark on 1010XL.
It's a veteran team. There's a different level of leadership, accountability, the character dynamic. Just look forward to coming to work, and I think the new staff has created some energy, and they're making an impact. The combination of those two things has me excited. I believe in our team. I do. I walked off the field today. I think we've got a chance to have a good football team.
There you go. The thoughts of Florida Gator head football coach Billy Napier. Spring practice going on down in Gainesville. The Orange and Blue game 2 weeks from Saturday. As spring practice, we're right in the middle of it, basically. About 2 weeks down, 2 weeks to go. Do they have the capability of being a good football team? Yeah, I guess, perhaps, but no one believes they're going to be any good, which is shocking to me. Even the you guys that have listened to me for years know that there have been certain times, yes, where I have drank a little orange and blue Kool-Aid. I may have had some orange and blue goggles on in the past, but you get older, you get wiser, you get more mature, you learn. And what I've learned, now being an objective broadcast journalist, is I don't have an awful lot of hope that Florida is going to have a good record this year. Does that mean they won't necessarily be a better football team than last year? No. I think you can be a better football team. You could stop doing ridiculously stupid things, like sending two players out there with the same jersey number. You can tackle guys before they run for 900 miles on you, as was the case in Kentucky and LSU last year. And you can do all those things, which would mean you're better, but I don't necessarily know if that's going to show up in the win-loss column. See, to me, this is the perfect storm. And I think the caveat that I always have to say, I guess it just makes me feel better when I say it, is I like Billy Napier. I like what he's doing. I like the staff he's assembled. I just genuinely like the guy. I did not particularly care for Jim McElwain. Dan Mullen, I was okay with, but I like Billy Napier. So I'm rooting for Billy Napier. But the problem is obvious. The problem is he's 11-14 in 2 years. The problem is the natives are restless. The problem is he needs to win in 2024. And the big problem he's got is that in 35 years of me following the Florida Gators, going back to probably 1990, when I was 6, 7 years old, it's about as far back as I can remember, Spurrier's first year, I can't remember a tougher schedule on paper than this one right now. And that's 3.5 decades. And Florida's played some hard opponents. I don't think they've ever played something like this. I mean, you can be the most diehard, dead set Florida Gator fan, Bull Gator booster on planet Earth. You look at those 12 games right now that Florida has, beginning August 31st with Miami and ending on November 30th at Doak Campbell Stadium. And all the games in between, look at all 12 of them, and you find me 6 wins. I don't think you're going to do it. Now, sometimes schedules are harder in March than they turn out to be in September and October. Sometimes schedules look more daunting this time of year than what materializes in 5, 6, 7 months. Injuries, teams failing to meet expectations, etc. And I certainly hope that's the case for the Gators. Because I look at this schedule, I went on with the Chuck Oliver show yesterday, and he asked me, you know, what about Billy Napier, you know, year three, what does he need to do? I said, I think he needs to make a bowl game, right? If you don't make a bowl game, I don't know. But again, to make a bowl game, you got to find 6 wins. Home against Miami, are they going to win that one? I mean, I guess hypothetically they could, but are you going to bet your life savings on it? Probably not. Samford at home? Yeah, you probably would bet pretty good money on that one. Home against Texas A&M? At Mississippi State? UCF? They just got the quarterback, KJ Jefferson, that put a 40-burger on you last year at Arkansas. At Tennessee? They're going to be fuming after what happened last year, and you got to go to Knoxville. Kentucky, they've beat you 3 years in a row. Then you come to Jacksonville for the cocktail party. You're going to beat the Dogs. Then you go to Texas. You get LSU at home. You never beat LSU, it seems. You get Ole Miss. Might be the best Ole Miss team they've had in decades. And then you go to Doak Campbell. Good grief. That is brutal. So again, I think Florida might be an improved football team this year. I don't know if it's going to say anything or show anything in regards to the win-loss column. Let's get one more thought in from Billy Napier. Obviously, people want to know about DJ Lagway. You got to remember something. This is Graham Mertz's football team, man. This is Graham Mertz's squad. I'm sure they'll work DJ Lagway in, the 5-star quarterback from the state of Texas. But Graham Mertz played well last year, and he's back for year two. More comfortable in the system. Granted, you got to replace Ricky Pearsall and Trevor Etienne, which won't be easy. But Billy Napier was asked about the progress of Graham Mertz and the progress of those young wide receivers down with the Gators.
Graham Mertz is a very capable passer, and I think he's proved over time when the pocket's clean, he can process and distribute the ball. We still need work with some of these young receivers. We've got some development to do there. But Chim DK's been a nice addition. He's proven here just in a couple days that I think he can make our team better.
Yeah, he needs to. That's a transfer from Wisconsin, right, the wide receiver. Obviously, Eugene Wilson will be the guy that's counted on the most. Guys like Andy Jean will have to step up. And then running back-wise, you got Montrell Johnson. Hey, Treyon Webb. Trinity Christian, Jacksonville product. I love seeing that for Treyon. Trevor Etienne's gone, gives an opportunity to a kid like Treyon Webb. I was a big fan of his, covering him at Trinity. I did a lot of stuff with Treyon interview-wise and whatnot. I'm really rooting for him. Florida, look, I mean, they got some talent. They're young in areas. I thought they did a decent job in the portal. But they have the hardest schedule in college football this year. It's not even close. You play 11 Power 5 teams. 11. The ESPN, way too early, top 25. 9 of the 25. 9 of them are on Florida's schedule. Brutal, man. Brutal. And I don't know if there's a more important game in the country August 31st than the Gators and the Hurricanes. I didn't say a better game. I think there might be better games. I said more important. Fan bases don't like one another. The teams don't play that often. Both programs desperately need to win, and both head coaches need that one. Cristobal needs that, and certainly Billy Napier needs that. So August 31st in Gainesville at the Swamp, that is absolutely gigantic between Miami and Florida to kick off the year. What a year it's going to be in college football, right? With the 12-team playoff, all the conference realignment. College football begins on August the 24th, which that includes Florida State, right? In Ireland, taking on Georgia Tech. And college football will not end until January 20th with the national championship game. Essentially 5 months of college football in what will be the biggest season ever in the history of college football with the 12-team playoff and with all the new conference realignment. More in the world of college football as the week goes on. We'll do a dive into Florida State later in the week. Might even take a look at Miami and Georgia as well. Coming up next, back into the National Football League. We are less than a month away. In fact, what is today? March 27th. We're 29 days, 4 months from, or four weeks from tomorrow till the NFL draft up in Detroit. Luke Easterling does a great job covering the draft, has so for years. He's with Athlon Sports. How did what the Jaguars did in free agency, how did that affect their draft outlook? And I want to take a look certainly at wide receiver and at defensive back. I think that's the direction, right? I think if I asked most of you right now, Jaguars, round one, round two, where are you going? A lot of you would say wide receiver. A lot of you would say DB. So I'll ask Luke Easterling about wide receiver and about DB. He comes up next. Hacker After Dark, in for Blue on a Wednesday, right here on 1010XL and 92.5 FM.
Remember the days of Bisselli, Brunell, Jimmy, and Keenan?
Mark Brunell with a masterful run.
Jaguars pride forever. 1010XL.
Baloo here for Smunez Vision. Why Smunez Vision? Well, I've been with Dr. Neil Smunez now since I got back to Jacksonville in 2006. 37 years of experience he has. Smunez Vision is a family organization that focuses on personal high-quality medical and surgical eye care. Dr. Catherine Smunez is fellowship-trained in cornea and cataract surgery and all refractive surgery. Combined, that's 30 years plus in laser eye surgery. Visit SmunezVision.com today. Here you can see.
At Honda, we appreciate all the comparisons to other vehicles. And no matter how many times they compare their vehicles to a Honda, only a Honda is a Honda. Remember, value, quality, safety. There is no substitute. Visit your local Honda dealer now and experience the difference.
Keeping your body healthy and active leads to a more vibrant life. A great place to do that is the First Coast YMCA. The Y is equipped with state-of-the-art cardio and strength equipment, plus group exercise studios where trainers host activities like yoga, Zumba, and cycling sessions. The full-court basketball gym and indoor five-lane swimming pool are open year-round. The Kid Zone can keep an eye on your kids while you work on that dad bod. And it's all available with your family membership. Learn more at fcymca.org.
Save big during MVP's bonus days at Lowe's with limited time deals on everything you need. Right now, buy one select DeWalt 20-volt max tool, get one DeWalt 20-volt max power stack battery 2-pack free, a $179 value. Plus, save $20 on a select bucket of Deck Plus wood screws. Find these deals and more in-store and online today. Because Lowe's knows savings. Lowe's knows pros. Valid 318 through 329 while supplies last. Selection varies by location.
Mia here, and let me tell you about one of our area's best resorts, the Sawgrass Marriott Golf Resort and Spa. The Sawgrass Marriott is not only a great destination for a vacation, but it is also a great destination for dining on the Florida's first coast. 1912 Ocean Bar and Rooftop is now open on Ponte Vedra Boulevard, featuring Ponte Vedra's only oceanfront rooftop bar and lounge. Serving finely crafted cocktails and delectable eats, it's open daily from 4 to 10 with complimentary valet parking.
Hi, I'm Sean Monahan from Monahan Jewelers in Atlantic Beach. Since 1977, we've been Jacksonville's family jeweler, where our true specialty is engagement rings and custom jewelry design. And now, buy your diamond engagement ring at Monahan's and get any diamond wedding band and men's wedding bands for 50% off. Come in and be treated like family for one of the most important purchases of your life. Buy your diamond engagement ring right now at Monahan's and get any diamond wedding band and gents band for 50% off. Come to Monahan Jewelers in Atlantic Beach or book an appointment at monahanjewelry.com.
Two rock legacies celebrate two iconic albums. Live and Stone Temple Pilots. Very special guest, Soul Asylum. The 30th anniversary of Throwing Copper and Verbal, the Jubilee Tour. Friday, August 30th at Daly's Place. Tickets on sale now at LiveNation.com. Don't miss Live and Stone Temple Pilots.
WJXL FM, Jacksonville Beach.
Is switching your wireless service to Total by Verizon easy?
Totalmente.
And you get unlimited 5G data? $25 a line for 4 lines on the unlimited plan? At an amazing price? With no contracts. Should you switch to Total by Verizon? Definitely.
Totalmente.
Find a store or switch suavemente at totalbyverizon.com. Monthly rate when you activate without a pay, plus taxes and fees. Discount begins the month after you enroll. Additional terms apply. See website for data management practices.
For any urological concerns, let Ackerman Urology be your trusted partner in men's health. With offices from Amelia Island to World Golf Village, they treat bladder conditions, elevated PSAs, and ED. Visit AckermanUrology.com.
You know what happens when a smart group of medical professionals get together and commit to a technology designed to relieve your aching joints without surgery? It's called QC Kinetics.
And this guy knows the power of a solid team. Emmett Smith, football legend and Dancing with the Stars champ.
This elite medical group, some of them orthopedic doctors, got together and said, why are we prescribing so many medications? Why are we sending so many people to surgery in droves? Let's change this.
The answer, natural biologics, our own healing properties. And the outcome is the country's largest provider of non-surgical regenerative treatments, QC Kinetics.
Actually, the real outcome are the tens of thousands of patients who finally got their quality of life back without surgery, thanks to QC Kinetics.
Call QC Kinetics, 904-274-5522. That's 904-274-5522. 904-274-5522.
They'll wear the helmets.
This should be fun to watch.
It's up to you if you want to wear the heels.
Helmets and Heels.
With Lauren, Taylor, and Mia. Switched on by First Coast Lighting and Fans.
And presented by Underwood Jewelers.
Tuesday nights at 6 on 1010XL. 1010XL is presented by Farrah and Farrah, exclusive injury law firm of the Jacksonville Jaguars. Protecting you and your family. Call 396-5555. Jacksonville. Let's ring up another guest on the All-Pro Roofing phone line.
Back here on 1010XL and 92.5 FM in the city of Jacksonville, we are glad you are with us. Free agency pretty much in the rearview mirror. The Jaguars are one of the most active teams in free agency. A lot of guys coming in, certainly some guys departing, including Calvin Ridley. And what does all that mean for the NFL draft now that is officially less than 1 month away? Luke Easterling of Athlon Sports always does a terrific job covering the NFL and the NFL draft, and he's kind enough to join us here on 1010XL in Jacksonville. Luke, how you doing?
Hey, I'm doing great, Ryan. How are you, man?
Hey, Luke, we're good, man. Thank you for the time. I know it's a very busy time of year for you, and this time of year that free agency starts winding down, obviously all eyes turn to the draft. Luke, how does free agency affect what you guys do in covering the NFL draft?
I mean, it has a huge impact on it, right? I mean, the best NFL teams know that you want to go into free agency and fill your biggest needs as best as you can with veteran guys who have experience to give you kind of an improved floor at those positions, right, where you know you can plug in guys who can play on Sunday and basically prevent you from having to reach to fill those positions early in the draft, right? You don't want to go into the draft saying, wow, we really whiffed, you know, on free agents at this one position. That means we've got to take that position within the first two or three rounds, and the board might not fall that way. You know, you don't want to put yourself in a position where you're passing up better players at other positions because you simply just have to get somebody to improve a position that you weren't able to improve in free agency. So from that perspective, I think the Jaguars, you know, if you look at the moves that they made, I think that they attacked that as best they could, right? They looked and they saw, you know, a hole along the interior of the offensive line. They bring in Mitch Morse, a guy who has a ton of experience and played at a really high level in Buffalo. Obviously, they lose Calvin Ridley. They bring in Gabe Davis, who's been a big play guy. I don't think he replaces what you're losing in Calvin Ridley, which is why I think that'll still be a high priority in the draft. And part of that is due to the fact that this draft class is so loaded at receiver. But even on defense, you know, Eric Armstead, I thought, was a huge addition for them. Even some of the smaller ones, Ronald Darby, Darnell Savage, guys that you're plugging into the starting lineup that can give you a certain level of production and expectation so that when you go into the draft, you know, depending on how the board falls, you can follow the talent and follow the value at any number of positions instead of feeling like you have to reach for a specific one. So from that perspective, I think the Jaguars did a pretty solid job getting somebody in every spot that they really needed. I think that the kind of dark horse, the elephant in the room, I think is the edge defender situation, depending on what happens with Josh Allen. If they're not able to retain him and have a contract standoff or what have you off the franchise tag, that would be a big hole that they'd need to fill. But otherwise, they did a pretty solid job.
Luke Easterling of Athlon Sports. Luke, you and I talked a little over a month ago, and at that time, it was interior offensive line, interior defensive line. Let's begin there. Do you feel the addition of Mitch Morse and the re-signing of Ezra Cleveland, does that take interior O-line off the board for the Jaguars in round one, in your opinion?
Probably in round one, I think it does. I think long-term, they would still like to bolster the depth there and have some upside that could challenge those guys. But I think first round, it really points you to the premium positions. I think corner and receiver, again, assuming that Josh Allen's situation works out and that he's back and they have both him and Trayvon Walker on the edges, I really think that not just the need long-term over the next 3 to 5 years, but the depth of the class itself, the talent that's likely to be on the board, assuming that the Jags stay at 17 where they are now. I think that points them to receiver, and it points them to corner, two of the increasingly premium positions in today's league.
Luke Easterling of Athlon Sports. I agree with you, wide receiver and corner, and we'll get more focus on those in a moment. You know, you mentioned Josh Allen, and for the life of me, I can't imagine Trent Baalke is going to allow that to happen. They're going to have to figure out a way to get something done there, or there will be problems here in Duval County, I can assure you, with the thoughts of Trent Baalke towards the fan base. So let's assume that Josh Allen does get done, whether it's today, tomorrow, or sometime, you know, prior to July 15th. My thought is, Luke, I mean, look, I love Josh Allen, Trayvon Walker, Eric Armstead, as you mentioned. But man alive, I'm seeing a lot of mocks with, like, Jared Verse just sitting there at 17. And if Jared Verse is sitting there at 17, boy, don't you have to consider that, even though you got a pretty good threesome there on the D-line with Armstead, Walker, and Allen?
Well, I think if that's the scenario that you end up in, that's where you try to convince yourself that the versatility of Trayvon Walker allows you to take a guy like Verse because of all the different things you can do with Walker along that entire defensive front. And so because you can slide him inside if you want to, and he can still win, I don't know if you'd want to do that full time, but like you said, a guy like Verse who is so polished, so ready to make an impact at the pro game, he's such a well-rounded guy. He can win with speed. He can win with power. He can defend the run. He can set a strong edge there and not just be a one-dimensional defender there on the edge. I think all of those things, that's why you drafted a guy like Walker, right? Because of the upside, the versatility, the athleticism he brings, and the way he can line up anywhere on the defensive front. So I think in that scenario, if you're saying, hey, Jared Verse is the best available player on the board regardless of position, let's see if we can't use Trayvon Walker's versatility to our advantage and just get the best four guys on the field. I would have a hard time arguing against the fact that Josh Allen, Trayvon Walker, Eric Armstead, and Jared Verse wouldn't be the best four guys you could run out there.
Man, that was that's quite a thought if the Jaguars would do that. Now, everybody is pointing towards a wide receiver and DB, and let's go there next. Doug Peterson in Orlando earlier this week made some news saying that Darnell Savage, the safety they brought in from Green Bay, is going to be looked at more as a nickel here in Jacksonville, and that was big because the thought was, Luke, the Jaguars were going to look at corner in a big way in round one. Well, all of a sudden, if you consider Darnell Savage as your nickel corner, now you got Tyson Campbell, Ronald Darby, and Darnell Savage. Does that maybe take corner down a peg, at least when it comes to pick 17?
I don't think so, and part of it is looking beyond this season. I think Ronald Darby is a solid signing for now, but I think you've got to look long-term. Who are you going to pair Campbell with on the outside beyond this season? And I think the best teams that know how to build through the draft have to look, you know, 3 years down the line, 5 years down the line, and say what's best for our team, not just this season, but beyond. And again, this applies to the offensive line as well with signings like Morse. You know, I think, again, the corner class is going to give them so much value there at 17. I think we could get to 17 and only have one, maybe two corners off the board. So, you know, you're talking about Nate Wiggins from Clemson, Kool-Aid McKinstry from Alabama. I think probably, you know, Quinyon Mitchell and Terrion Arnold are probably off the board by then. But Cooper DeJean from Iowa, you want to talk about a versatile guy that can line up anywhere. I think there's going to be too much talent there. And again, if you look beyond this season, I think they'd really like to pair someone, a younger player, with Campbell on the outside for the future and not just this season.
If Arnold and Mitchell are gone, and I tend to agree with you, who do you have as the third corner?
I think it's going to depend on fit. I think if a team needs a versatile guy, that again, a guy like Cooper DeJean who can play on the outside, but he's really better as like a do-it-all rover kind of guy who can play inside in the slot. He lined up at linebacker sometimes for Iowa. They moved him all over the place, but he can play deep at safety. And so if you want more of a versatile, can line up anywhere kind of guy, you take Cooper DeJean. If you want just the outside traditional corner who's going to stay on the outside and lock down his side of the field, I think it's probably Nate Wiggins from Clemson, who, again, a little bit light, but I believe he put on a little bit of weight for his pro day and still ran really fast. So, you know, again, a guy with great ball skills, elite speed for the position, and he's tall. He's not big. You know, he could, again, hopefully add a little bit more weight there and make sure he can hold up. But Wiggins, again, with that kind of speed, those kind of instincts and ball skills that he shows on film, I think he could easily be that third corner off the board if you don't need the versatility that DeJean brings.
A couple of more for Luke Easterling of Athlon Sports, talking NFL draft with us here on 1010XL in Jacksonville. That brings me to wide receiver. And, Luke, a month ago I told you Jackson Powers Johnson was the very popular name here, the center from Oregon. He has been replaced by Brian Thomas, the wide receiver from LSU. My question to you, twofold. Talk about Thomas, and will he be there at 17?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a big question mark, because you've got obviously the top three receivers in this draft are all elite guys, right? You could make an argument that those three receivers are three of the top five overall players in this draft, talking about Marvin Harrison Jr., Malik Nabers, and Roma Dunze. So, you know, those guys could all be gone by six. I mean, we could see three, four quarterbacks and then three or four receivers off the board in the first six or seven picks. And then the next, you know, that drop off is significant, I think, but it's not about talent in the second tier. I think there's a ton of talent in that second tier. I think the difficulty for teams is going to be how much better is the fourth receiver on their board than the 10th receiver on their board. And I really don't think there's a lot separating those guys. I mean, we could, you know, Brian Thomas Jr., I think, is the top of that tier to me, because of his size and his speed and his production. I think there's a ton of upside there. But, I mean, if you look at the rest of that group, A.D. Mitchell and Xavier Worthy from Texas, even Ladd McConkey from Georgia, Keon Coleman from Florida State. You know, there's so many guys in that second tier of receivers that you could convince yourself, if you're picking to give you a scenario that as to why Thomas could still be on the board at 17 despite those numbers – it just could be a matter of all those teams. After those top three receivers are off the board, those next 10 picks or so, if anybody needs a receiver, are they going to be able to convince themselves, hey, I could take Brian Thomas Jr. here, or I could get a guy who's very, very comparable in terms of value on our board with our second round pick. And so it can free me up to take, you know, a tackle or something else that we need. So I think that's the scenario that could leave Thomas on the board for them. If he is still there, I think it's an easy pick. You know, you could make some skill set comparisons to what they signed in Gabe Davis, but I just don't think he brings the consistency. And I think there's a ton more upside again with Thomas. So if he's gone, again, you're talking about if there's still plenty of speed, if you want either of those Texas guys, Worthy or Mitchell, and there's still plenty to be had there. But Thomas is, I think, would be the real prize there at 17 if they want to go receiver.
So it sounds like, not to put words in your mouth, but if it were you, you would probably, if your needs are wide receiver and DB, you would go DB at 17, and then you'll find a receiver at 49 in the second round.
It's possible. I mean, yes and no. I think in the Jags position, if Thomas is there, I really like him so much that if no receiver has come off the board between that top 10 and 17 and you're able to get Thomas, I really feel confident in him as the fourth best receiver. And I think if everybody else kind of takes a pass and says and plays it that way, right, with like, hey, I can wait till the second round, then you kind of have to flip the other way and be like, okay, well, if everybody else is going to wait, I'm going to take advantage and get value at this position with a guy who probably should be a top 15 pick and in any other class might be top 10 with that size speed ratio that he has. And I'm going to get him at 17 because they pushed him down the board. And part of that is because there's going to be a huge run on those receivers that the Jags might completely miss out on by the time they get around to the late 40s, right? So, I mean, if you look at the top of the second round, you've got Carolina, you've got New England, you've got Tennessee, you've got so many teams in that, maybe Indy if they want somebody else to pair with Michael Pittman Jr. and the rest of that young core. There's so many teams picking in that from 18 right after the Jaguars pick in the first round to the time they come back up on the board. Those next 6 to 8 receivers could all be gone by the time they pick. And so I think that might contribute to them feeling like if no receiver has come off the board after those top three and they get a chance to get Thomas, they better get their guy there because there could easily be, again, 6 to 8 guys taken off that out of that class before they come up on the clock again.
Final moments with Luke Easterling of Athlon Sports. Luke, locally, people love Ricky Pearsall and people love Keon Coleman, the Seminole and Gator fans here. Your thoughts on both Pearsall and Coleman, and could potentially either guy still be there at 49?
Yeah, I think Pearsall is probably the guy that's more likely to be there at 49. Wouldn't necessarily shock me if Coleman makes it that far. But again, I think two very different guys who, you know, Coleman, obviously big, physical, 6'4", 215, plays faster than his time speed. I know the 40-yard dash is one thing, but if you look at his kind of analytic numbers, the speed that he's moving at when he's actually playing football, he's so much faster on the field than he was at the combine. And so again, you're getting a red zone guy who can outleap anybody, great at the catch point in those 50-50 balls, those contested catches, plays with a lot of physicality, knows how to use his size. So that's the type of guy that you're getting there. And Pearsall is just, he does everything so well. He's so polished. He can line up outside. He can line up in the slot. He's tough. He'll go over the middle and make those tough catches. I know everybody's seen that one-hander that'll live in Gator history forever. But he's such a sharp route runner, reliable hands, really smart player. And I think, again, he does everything at such a high level that somebody's going to fall in love with him. Again, it's the depth of receiver class. Normally a guy like him would be a second-round lock. But the depth of this class could push him towards the end of that second round, beginning of the third round. And I think that whoever ends up with him is going to be very, very happy because I think he's a guy that can make an immediate impact because he can do everything at such a high level.
Luke, final question, man. Again, thank you. I know you're very busy this time of year. As far as guys that – give me one guy that you have really climbing in the last couple of weeks, maybe since the combine, and one guy maybe that's in a little bit of a free fall right now.
You know, I think the guy that I have the highest in terms of the combine and what it did, I think it really solidified Dallas Turner from Alabama as the best defensive prospect in this draft. I think when you go out as an edge defender at, you know, 6'4", 250 plus, and you're running in the 4.4s and you're doing the things in the agility drills that he did, I think he's probably the only defensive player that goes in the top 10. I think Atlanta at 8 makes a lot of sense for him. If he's not going there, he probably goes to Chicago at 9. But I think he might be the easy pick to be the first defender off the board. And especially after that combine, I think he solidified himself in that spot. And I'm not, you know, I'm trying to rack my brain for somebody that maybe Audric Estime, you know, the running back from Notre Dame, didn't have a great combine. And I think if teams are looking for a reason to disqualify a guy in the running back class, maybe that's him. But I thought he had a much better pro day, the Notre Dame running back. I think he's a tough, powerful guy. So you know, if teams do kind of push him down the board because he ran slow at the combine, I think they're going to regret that because he's a guy that, again, the running back class is very interesting. Really, the top 8 to 10 guys could go in any order. I think Trey Benson's probably the top guy in that group. But Estime is a guy who, if he falls because he didn't run as fast as expected, I think he's a guy that will make teams regret letting him stay on the board until the fourth round if that happens, because he's just such a tough, instinctive runner.
Luke, tell the good folks here in Jacksonville, man. I know Athlon Sports, you guys put the draft guide out. You were a big part of that. Where can people get their hands on it?
Yeah, I mean, you can find that anywhere you find your magazines, your grocery stores, your Barnes & Nobles, your bookstores, anywhere. That's out. Definitely had a lot of fun putting that together. But we've got a lot of that content going up on the Athlon Sports website as well. So come over to athlonsports.com. We'll have the mock drafts, the scouting reports, all the news, breaking down everything, all the rumors heading up. Everybody knows that the rumor mill is going to start churning over the next few weeks here as we lead into the draft, and it's going to be pretty crazy, but we'll have it all covered for you there at athlonsports.com.
He's one of the best when it comes to draft coverage, Luke Easterling, Athlon Sports, and he's always kind enough to give us some time here on 1010XL in Jacksonville. Luke, thank you as always. Let's do it again after the draft, and we'll see where the dust has settled with the Jacksonville Jaguars.
Hey, sounds great, man. Always a good time.
Baloo for Shenactory Chiropractic. They've helped me get rid of my headaches and pain in my neck and back. Are you suffering from an auto accident? What about TMJ pain? Headaches associated with jaw clenching, grinding of the teeth, or stress-related disorders? Shenactory Chiropractic has a physical therapist on staff for rehabilitation, quality chiropractic care, dry needling massage, and acupuncture. Call 743-6700. Or go to ShenactoryDC.com.
There are only a few things the government does well, and processing passports is not one of them. Hello, it's Congressman Aaron Bean, and taking care of constituents in Northeast Florida is a top priority. If you need help with that passport, the VA, Social Security, or any federal agency, call my office, 904-557-9550, or visit bean.house.gov. I'm Congressman Aaron Bean, and serving you is what we do. Paid for by official funds authorized by the House of Representatives.
Hey, Hicken here. You know I'm a hometown guy. There's nothing like home in Jacksonville, Florida. What a great place to live. Spring is here and everything is green and blooming. But that means I'll have to cut the lawn soon. It also means that we'll need to do some deep cleaning inside the house. That's where Zero Res comes in. Zero Res can clean your tile and grout, the carpets, your area rug, furniture, and more. Right now, they're offering 25% off tile and grout cleaning. Zero Res, man, spelling forwards or backwards. The right way to clean.
Zero Res.
Right now, say big at Key Buick GMC. Like up to $15,000 off all new GMC trucks, or choose $9,000 in savings with 2.9 APR financing for up to 72 months. Need some low APR rates? Key Buick GMC has them. Rates as low as 1.9% for 36 months, 3.9% for 48 months, 4.9% for up to 60 months, and 5.9% APR for up to 72 months. Across the street from Tinseltown, Key Buick GMC.
The Wing Madness menu at Boston's Restaurant and Sports Bar is a slam dunk. Sink your teeth into our mouth-watering rib or cauliflower wings, available in 16 amazing flavors. Try their trash can nachos, layers of crispy tortilla chips piled high with all the fixings, and their flavorful, addictive corn wings. You'll be hoarding these like a sneaky technical foul. Get 50% off bone-in or boneless wings on our loyalty program. All the details and restrictions at Boston's.com today.
Doc Rooter is a full-service plumbing company that's locally owned and operated, fully licensed and insured. We'll be at your home in a timely manner, provide honest pricing, and ensure the job is completed correctly, or we'll make it right. Doc Rooter can handle all plumbing jobs, including repairing broken pipes, clearing clogged drains, to installing new fixtures, water heaters, garbage disposals, and full repipes for older homes. If you're stuck, call the Doc, 904-862-6769. That's 904-862-6769.
Pull. Put your team together for Operation New Uniforms Veterans Cup Clay Shoot on Friday, April 5th. This year's fundraiser will feature celebrity shooters, great food, prizes, and of course, bragging rights for the winners. Enjoy a day on the range and support Operation New Uniform's mission to empower transitioning service members, veterans, and military spouses. Find their new uniform in the business world. Go to onuvets.org. That's onuvets.org today.
Hacker here, and most of us have a closet full of clothes ranging in sizes. keeping around the smaller ones for when we plan to fit into them again. If you told me just a month ago I'd already be wearing a full shirt size smaller, I'd laugh. But thanks to Awaken 180, dropping 35 pounds in just 4 weeks, this guy has already dropped a full shirt size. Notches on my belt, too. Crazy results, and I'm just getting started. The best part? I'm not on this journey alone. My Awaken 180 coach, Kate, is there whenever I need her. I've tried other programs before, but I have never received the kind of results and support I'm getting with Awaken 180. 35 pounds in 4 weeks, and I feel better than I have in years. What's stopping you? Do what Mike Dempsey, Matt Hayes, and I did. Make the call to Awaken 180. 844-346-1800. That's 844-346-1800. Or online at awaken180weightloss.com.
To thank you for 40 unforgettable years, Dell Technologies is celebrating with anniversary savings on their most popular tech. For a limited time only, save on select next-gen PCs, like the XPS 13 Plus, powered by Intel Core processors, and more. Plus, curate your dream setup with great deals on select monitors, mice, and more must-have electronics and accessories. When you shop online at dell.com/deals, you'll have access to leading-edge technology and free shipping on everything. Again, that's dell.com/deals.
1010XL is presented by Farrah & Farrah, exclusive injury law firm of the Jacksonville Jaguars. Protecting you and your family. Call 396-5555. Jacksonville. This is Hacker After Dark on 1010XL.
And again, thank you to Luke Easterling of Athlon Sports for joining us this evening here on Hacker After Dark. The National Basketball Association. We are now 10 games, roughly. Most teams have 10, 11 games left in the regular season. The NBA playoffs are just a couple of weeks away. And just to our south, our neighbors down in Orlando, the Magic, having one of their best years in the last decade plus. I think you got to go back to 2011, 2012 to find when they were 13 games or more above 500. That's where they sit tonight, heading into their game against Golden State. Jake Chapman is the play-by-play voice of the Orlando Magic. We'll talk a little Orlando. We'll look at the Eastern Conference and kind of where Orlando stands as, again, we are less than 3 weeks away from the NBA playoffs. Talking association on a Wednesday night edition of Hacker After Dark with Dylan Denmark, the Hacker Ryan Green with you here on 1010XL and 92.5 FM.
The station that covers the Jaguars day in and day out.
It's not the old Jaguars team. We're not pushovers, so I mean, we're going to fight back.
1010XL, home of the Jaguars.
Here's Linda Beaver.
Did you hear what's happening? Beaver Toyota and Beaver Chevrolet are spring cleaning. New inventory on the ground means we need to make more room. Take advantage of huge savings on thousands of vehicles priced to sell. New and pre-owned prices have been reduced, and all sales associates have been instructed to give maximum value on all trades. But you better hurry. The best deals go first. Head to Beaver Toyota in St. Augustine
or Beaver Chevrolet in Jacksonville to take advantage of our spring cleaning sale. We're here to wow you.
Hard Rock Bet presents Legal in Florida.
You can bet the game on Hard Rock Bet. No more betting inside your head.
A no-regret first bet up to $100 when you sign up now. Offered by the Seminole Tribe of Florida. Must be 21 and over and physically present in Florida to wager. Terms and conditions apply. Concerned about gambling? Please call 1-888-ADMITTED.
Get ready to rock your evening with the band Be Easy at Players Grill Mandarin, a high-energy, multi-genre cover band from classic hits to chart toppers. See you at Players Grill Mandarin Friday, April 5th at 8 p.m. Players Grill, where the neighborhood meets.
David Garrard here. Playing in the NFL can put a lot of wear and tear on your body, especially your knees. Southeast Orthopedic Specialist has kept me mobile and ready to tackle every day.
Southeast Orthopedic Specialist.
David Garrard here. I've had the PRP treatment from Southeast Orthopedic Specialist, and my knees are really doing well. Platelet-rich plasma treatment may be the answer for whatever is hurting you.
Southeast Orthopedic Specialist.
Give a man a fish, he'll eat for a day. Teach a man to fish, and he's listening to the Nimnicht Outdoor Show.
With tips and stories.
Presented by Duck Duck Rooter Plumbing and Septic Services.
Every Saturday morning, 7 to 10.
On 1010XL.
Wondering what you're going to do for dinner tonight? Southern Steer Butcher is a full-service butcher, and we grind and make sausage in-house every day.
Now open in Ortega. For tasty tips and juicy breasts, choose Southern Steer Butcher.
That's Mike saying good morning. It's the best he can do right now. Yeah, not a cloud in the sky. What Mike could use is a fresh start. And Irish Spring Body Wash. The fresh scent of Irish Spring and those sensational Irish Spring suds are just the reset Mike needs. Now he's ready
to go to work.
It's Sunday. Irish Spring. When the spring hits you, you're ready. Pick up Irish Spring at Walmart today.
Imagine waking up this time next week and being 100% debt-free. No credit cards, no car loan, no personal loan. Hey, it's Prosser here, and Loan Pronto's Equity Express line of credit can make that happen. Homeowners are turning their home equity into cash almost instantly. With Loan Pronto's AI-based system, you can get approval in about 10 minutes with almost no documentation, no appraisal, and no hassle. You can get hundreds of thousands of dollars out of your home. Use that money to pay off all your other loans. The average homeowner saves over $850 a month doing this. Listen, your home value's way up. You can use that to wipe out all those credit cards, get some money for a home improvement. Literally, hundreds of thousands are at your fingertips, and approval is just minutes away. So call now, 904-999-1508. 904-999-1508. That's loanpronto.com at 904-999-1508. NMLS 1661781, subject to lender approval, equal housing lender.
If you're ready to upgrade your home's backyard living appeal and just need some design inspiration, let the experts at Art of Natural Stone make your outdoor living perfect. Known for summer kitchens, pergolas, pavers, patios, and pool decks using all natural stone. All the custom elements you need for a first-class professional design, and they do installation. Open to the public on Phillips Highway and on Beach Boulevard. Find ideas online at artofnaturalstone.com.
It's March basketball. That means a host of top teams will be competing for the NCAA title. When it comes to commercial painters, there's also some healthy competition out there. Jason Parker with Performance Painting. To help you know the right questions to ask any painter competing for your business this year, visit performancepaintingjacks.com. Or if you're ready for a friendly quote, give us a call and ask about our free pressure wash promotion for your next project. Performance Painting, quality coatings applied with pride.
Performance Painting.
It's Kubota Orange Days, your golden chance to score a deal that will make your neighbors green with envy. Shop the year's best selection of Kubota tractors, zero-turn mowers, and utility vehicles, including the number one selling compact tractor in the USA. And get the year's best deals, like 0% APR for 84 months or up to $3,300 off L3302 tractors. Coastal Equipment on New Kings Road and in McClenny.
Coastal Equipment.
1010XL is presented by Farrah & Farrah, exclusive injury law firm of the Jacksonville Jaguars. Protecting you and your family. Call 396-5555. Jacksonville. Let's ring up another guest on the All-Pro Roofing phone line.
Back here on 1010XL and 92.5 FM in the city of Jacksonville, we are glad you are with us. The Orlando Magic, one of the best turnarounds in the NBA. They currently have already clinched a spot in at least the play-in tournament, but their aspirations are a lot bigger than that. They're only a game outside of the three seed right now in the Eastern Conference playoffs, currently sitting at the five spot right behind the New York Knicks, who are currently in fourth. Let's talk Orlando Magic, let's talk the turnaround, and let's talk about this playoff run that they hopefully will be on over the following weeks with Jake Chapman of Orlando Magic Radio. He's always kind enough to join us here on 1010XL in Jacksonville. Jake, how you doing?
I'm good, Ryan. How are you, bud?
Jake, we're good, man. Thank you for the time, as always. And boy, I told you before we started, I'm a long-suffering Orlando Magic fan. My uncle took me to a game at the Orlando Arena back in 1989, and that was a curse for the last 35 years with this organization. I've lived and died with them for 3.5 decades, through the good and through the bad. And, Jake, before we really dive in, man, it certainly appears that we're on one of those good streaks right now as this young team is finding a lot of ways to win games.
You know, it's funny. I just turned 40 a few weeks ago, and I grew up in Cleveland, Ohio, as a Cavaliers, Indians, and then Guardians and Browns fan. So I can certainly relate to Magic fans and the pain and misery that that living and dying with sports teams can cause. And then, look, as far as the Magic go, when you go up to 30,000 feet, it's actually been a pretty successful franchise going back to 89, now 35 years. And at the very least, you've made two finals runs. Obviously, I haven't been able to get over the hump. But with all that said, it's been lean times for what? Basically, since Dwight left. I mean, you had two playoff appearances in, I guess, what, the last 12 seasons. And with those Steve Clifford teams, as fun as they were, and it was great getting back to the postseason at that point with that core, I think most Magic fans had a sense that there was probably a little bit of a ceiling with that group. And certainly Jeff Weltman in his front office figured that eventually. And so what we're seeing now is going back, what, 3 years now, the payoff. And you decide to sort of blow that group up. You trade away a bunch of veterans. You trade away players as good as Nikola Vucevic and Aaron Gordon and Evan Fournier. You're probably not going to get better immediately. And so we've had to be patient these last couple seasons. Coach Mosley, I think, has done an incredible job of laying down a culture and a foundation and building from there. And then obviously the biggest, you can be the greatest coach in the world. If you don't got the talent, it's not going to matter. The biggest developments have been drafting and hitting on picks like Paolo Banchero and Franz Wagner. And this year, I think we can safely say Jalen Suggs is in that group. He's had an outstanding season. So I think it's exciting to be thinking about the postseason. It's exciting to be playing important basketball games coming down the stretch here. That's been a while since we've had that. But what's really exciting is just thinking about, how sustainable this thing could be and how long we could be a playoff team and potentially a championship contending team because of how young we are. Right now, we're the third youngest team in the league. And as you said, the last two seasons, you've seen pretty substantial bumps as far as the wins go. So I think we're at the beginning of something pretty special, and I hope so anyways.
Jake Chapman of Orlando Magic Radio here with us on 1010XL in Jacksonville. Jake, I'll raise my hand because the draft back in, 2023, I guess, right, whenever Banchero was drafted, 2022, and I was all about Jabari Smith, man. I mean, Jabari Smith, the SEC guy, I had my SEC Homer glasses on. I wanted Orlando to take the sharpshooter from Auburn. And if they didn't take him, I'm thinking, all right, maybe Chet Holmgren, obviously. And then they draft Banchero. And I had about a 48 to 72-hour window where I was just like, what are they doing? And I have never been happy to be more wrong in my life. You always want to draft that dude, right, at number one in the NBA. And, Jake, there's no question to me Orlando drafted a dude in Paolo Banchero.
Yeah, I think dude's the best way to describe it. Matter of fact, Dante Marcatelli tells a story. He was doing the game with Quentin Richardson for Bally Sports Florida, the first game of Paolo Banchero's career against the Pistons. And Dante said it took about 5 minutes before Quentin Richardson turned to him and said, "We got a dude. We got a dude." And he is. That's exactly what he is. He plays night in and night out. Every game matters. He's a competitor. He's a dog, man. I mean, he wants dogs around him, and he wants guys who play, and he wants guys who take a game in April as seriously as a game in November and vice versa. And I was kind of with you. I was enamored by Chet Holmgren, and I don't think either of us were wrong. Those are both really good players. But Paolo Banchero is, I think it's interesting because a lot of times we knock guys at Duke. He's at Duke, so he's putting up numbers. Look at all the NBA talent he's playing with. And a guy like Paolo was so physically dominant in that lone season at Duke. I think people overlooked how smart a basketball player he was. And that has never been more apparent than here in year two. He's getting doubles sent at him constantly, Ryan, and he's making the right play every single time. I mean, I expected a whole bunch more sort of bumps in the road as he adjusted to how teams are defending him. And you just see the assist numbers jumping. The team is still winning. The offense has been better since New Year's and certainly since the All-Star break. And it's all been sort of him with in the middle of all of it. You throw Franz Wagner in there as well. They're both such heady players and they're both such competitors that I think the franchise is in very good hands, but you weren't alone. I mean, obviously Paolo was going to be one of the top three picks, but there were strengths and weaknesses that everybody assessed. And that's the beauty of the NBA draft. And I'll say this as well, a lot of that stuff, it is contingent on the situation they're drafted into. You know, these guys are blank slates when they're 19 years old. And so I think Paolo came to a good place, the good infrastructure. And I think it's worked out great, not just because of the player and competitor he is, but because of everything that's happened around him.
You mentioned Nick Vucevic. He's probably one of my top 10, maybe top five all-time favorite players. That guy battled his tail off through some really down years in Orlando. And I'm so used to Orlando making awful trades that when they sent Vucevic to Chicago for Wendell Carter and a couple of draft picks, I'm thinking, oh my gosh, I think Otto Porter was in that trade too, and he obviously was just a salary issue. So Wendell Carter comes to Orlando, and I'm thinking, okay, the guy that's always hurt. Well, the injuries have still followed him to Orlando, but when Wendell Carter's healthy, he's been phenomenal, and then I had no idea to know that one of those first-round draft picks that they got from the Bulls in the Vucevic trade would turn out to be one of the best young players in the league, and Franz Wagner. Jake, there's no question Orlando fleeced Chicago in that deal.
Yeah, for sure. And I think the Bulls will tell you, because you had two different organizations in two different places. The Bulls are, at the very least, they're in the play-in tournament right now. They're struggling. But I think they knew they needed to make a move. You know, you're talking about guys in front office members and all of that kind of protecting their jobs. I for sure they would want those picks back. You'd think they would want Wendell back. I'll say this, though. Vooch has been very good for them, as we knew he would be. Vooch is a great player. And he is one of our favorites. Like, I don't think when you go through and you just look at the record books and you look at the tenure, it's a handful of guys who are above Nick Vucevic as far as the all-time Orlando Magic greats go. But it's worked out very well. And it was one of those things where at that time, as I said, like, you knew you weren't going to get better trading away an all-star. It was coming off a second all-star appearance, and a team leader like Nick Vucevic, but you had to tear it down to the studs, and you had to bring in guys that, you know, had upside, and some of those guys didn't work out. You know, you think about RJ Hampton and Mo Bamba, who was already here, obviously. And some of the guys that, you know, you took flyers on and it didn't work out, but you have to keep taking wax at the tree. And that was the whole sort of notion behind that, was we're probably not going to hit on all of our draft picks. So let's add a whole bunch of them. Right. And let's make sure, we've got some currency for the future, which we still have. We still have that Denver pick, still have all of our own picks, and we have cap flexibility. And so if you hit on those draft picks, and Anthony Black is one of those as well, this last draft that kind of closed out that Chicago deal. When you hit on those picks, you give yourself a little bit of cushion to be able to take some more risks. And you bring in a guy like Bol Bol, and no, it doesn't work out, but he plays for you for a year. But also you bring in a guy like Mo Wagner that year. If you remember, it was, 6 weeks after we traded everybody away that we brought in Mo. He was almost on his way out of the league, and he's now an invaluable piece of this bench. So when you go into those rebuilds, you need to be smart about protecting your assets. And then, as you mentioned, you can't short circuit it. You can't get to a point where you say, okay, we're close, now we got to cash everything in and go for it. You want to maintain that flexibility, because you never quite know what kind of deal is going to become apparent, and you got to be patient. Like, we've improved, obviously, dramatically the last two seasons, but I don't think we're there yet. I think the idea is, when Paolo and Franz are reaching their peaks, let's make sure we're able to build a championship level team around them. And as you know, as difficult as it is to say, we're not quite there yet. So you got to be patient. You got to kind of let it breathe and let these guys develop at their own pace.
A couple of more for Jake Chapman of Orlando Magic Radio. He's here with us on 1010XL in Jacksonville. Jake, Jalen Suggs, people knew him because of the shot, right, in the Final Four and the Gonzaga point guard. He comes into the league and quite frankly, wasn't very good, I guess. I mean, maybe that's not fair, but I think year one and year two might have underwhelmed people for Jalen being a top five pick. And I don't know what happened this past offseason. Jalen Suggs looks like a different guy right now. And I got to tell you, people always talk about the big three. You think to Wade, Bosh, and LeBron in Miami, other configurations throughout the years. Orlando's not there yet, but very rarely do you build your own big three in-house. Man, with Wagner, with Banchero, and the way Suggs is playing, Orlando might be doing that right now.
Yeah, I think when you're Orlando, it's not quite as easy to do it as Miami or Los Angeles or even a Brooklyn does, where you're just trading for guys or signing free agents. Like, you can trade for guys, but you're gonna have to trade for them at at the beginning of their ascendance, right? And you got to be smart about it. And that was what Jeff Weltman's been talking about building something sustainable, is doing it through the draft, because that's the only way we can guarantee these guys are going to be here for, two contracts, the extension after the end of their rookie deal. And I think that was the plan in the first place. I think part of what's happened with Jalen Suggs is the emergence of Franz and Paolo, right? Like, you're right. The first 2 years, at least offensively, were not good. And he'll be the first to tell you that. I mean, he was one of the worst offensive players in the league, as far as percentages go and turnovers and all of that stuff. We always saw the flashes defensively, but Jalen also had problems staying on the floor. And so I think what happened last summer was, and he's talked about his mental, like he kind of got back to, okay, why am I doing this? What do I love about basketball? How do I enjoy this more? How do I forget about the expectations of being the fifth pick and all of the attention paid to him at Gonzaga because of the shot, X, Y, and Z? And how do I just get back to doing what I love and doing it well? And he worked on his jumper as well, which I think helped. But I think what's happened is his role has been kind of limited offensively. Like, the ball's just not in his hands as much. He's more of a spot-up shooter because of the emergence of Paolo and Franz. And now, all of a sudden, he's developing at a little bit slower rate offensively. But I think that's a good thing. I think you strip away all the responsibilities. You say, spot up on offense and hit open threes, which he's done, like, very well. He shoot 42% from three since New Year's. And you do that, and then you can build everything back on. And then all of a sudden you're attacking the hoop against uneven defenses and closeouts rather than a set defense waiting for you. And now you got to finish among the trees, or you got to, try to get to the rack with three sets of arms hacking down on you and on the ball. So I think it's all kind of worked, together. The emergence of Paolo and Franz as your primary options offensively, Jalen sliding into more of a spot up, knockdown shooter type player. But then the defensive end, I mean, we're talking about an all defensive team type guy. He is that good on that end. And that is the role that they envisioned when they drafted him. And that is the role that he's going to play no matter what. There's going to be nights where he doesn't make any shots or makes a handful of shots. He can impact the game every single night on the other end of the floor. And that's what you need, right? You need one of your big three, or at the very least, one of your foundational pieces to be that good defensively. We got a guy coming off the bench who, if we can just keep him on the floor, and Jonathan Isaac is that good. And now we got a guy who has done a much better job in year three of staying on the floor, and Jalen Suggs, who he just wrecks defensive sets every night. I mean, it's such a joy to watch him, not to mention what he does at home at Kia Center, the way he responds to the energy of the crowd and they him. It's just been a joy to watch him this year. And he's talked a lot about, I just kind of forgot about all of the expectations and got back to doing what I love. And I think you're seeing those results.
Final moments, Jake Chapman, Orlando Magic Radio. And the great thing about this roster too, Jonathan Isaac, Mo Wagner, Joe Ingles, Cole Anthony, Markel Fultz, Goga Batadze, Anthony Black, those guys don't start, right? They're coming off the bench. Orlando is one of the deepest teams in the NBA. Jake, we got 2 minutes to go. Real quick, are they ahead of schedule? I mean, I, as a Magic guy, I thought maybe they would challenge for a play-in spot. To me, that's my expectation. I mean, there's a real chance they could have home court in round one of the playoffs if things go their way. Are they maybe a year ahead of where people thought?
Yeah, I think so. I think the job isn't done yet. I think right now you're really gunning for a top six seed. Like, if you dropped right now, you are 3.5 clear of Miami in that seven seed with 11 to play. If you drop to the play-in scenario, it's going to be disappointing. It's still very possible that happens. We've got a tough schedule coming up. We're working our way through this 8-game homestand. We just had a couple days off, so big games here tonight, Friday, the Clippers, it's the Warriors tonight, it's the Clippers in on Friday, and then you wrap up that 8-game homestand with Memphis and with Portland, which, should be winnable games, but you never quite know. Those are teams you don't see very often. And then it gets tough as well into April. You got Milwaukee coming up twice, coming down the stretch. So it's going to be a grind from here on out. But, you kind of built up a bit of a cushion earlier in the season. And then certainly in February, kind of wrapped around the All-Star break, you had the schedule broke. You had a whole bunch of you know, sub 500 teams right there in a row. I think it was 11 out of 12 at one point was the stretch, and you were able to beat up on those teams as good teams do, right? You got to take care of business first and foremost against sub 500 teams. I would say for sure they're ahead of schedule just because, you know, at the beginning of the season, your expectations, Ryan, were just about everybody's. So, like, we all talked, even at media day, the players and coaches, about, yeah, we need to be not gunning, not hoping and on the outside looking in for a play-in spot. Coming down the stretch in March and into April, we need to be in that scenario and hoping to get a little bit higher. I think, look, I mean, bottom line is you at this point have won 42 games. It's been like a decade, I think, since you've won that many games. You're 13 games above 500. I know it's been a decade since you were 13, 14 games above 500, if not more. I mean, you're going back to the 11-12 season, I believe, for the last time you were this good this late in the season. And you're the third youngest team in the league. So I think if you can guarantee, or if you can work your way into a first round playoff series, best of seven, top six seed in the Eastern Conference, that'll be a home run. And even if you don't, you still are going to feel like, boy, we're cooking with gas here. The best is yet to come. And so, I think if you had met expectations this year, if right now you were in the nine seed and, you know, you were kind of about where you intended to be, it would still be a success story, because as we know, these rebuilds don't always work the way this has. You extended your head coach, which means that things are going right, that everybody's on the same page. I think that was a big development. But I would say for sure you're ahead of schedule, and the real test is coming. These last 11 games are going to feel like the playoffs. And then we'll see what happens. I think with our size, our physicality, and the way we defend, I don't think anybody wants to see us in round one of the postseason. But as we know, it's a completely different game when you get there. And no matter what, we're going to learn lessons coming down the stretch here, and we're going to be better off for it. So that's the silver lining, is when you're the third youngest team in the league and you're playing big games like this at this point, win, lose, or draw, it's going to make you better in the long run.
You can sense the excitement up here, I can tell you. I don't normally talk a lot of Orlando Magic basketball. I would love to. There was just no reason to on my show the last few years. I'm talking it this year because people here in Jacksonville, again, it's only an hour and 40 minutes. I tell people, you want a fun night? Go down, if you want to get a little ambitious, it's about an hour and 40, down to the Kia Center. You can park right there in the garage, use the walkway to the arena, enjoy the ball game, walk back to the garage, get back on I-4, you're home an hour and 40 minutes later. It is a fun night, unless, of course, you want to hit Corona's Cigar Bar down there on Church Street, which is certainly my go-to when I head to Orlando Magic ball games. Jake Chapman of Orlando Magic Radio. Jake, really enjoyed the conversation, man. Thank you. Let's hopefully do it again as the playoffs approach.
Anytime, man. Appreciate it. Have a good one.
And thank you to Jake Chapman, Orlando Magic Radio, for joining us tonight here on Hacker After Dark, as, yeah, the Magic have been one of the most improved teams in the NBA, and as a Magic fan, it is a long time coming, but I am enjoying every minute of it. Jamal Mosley is in his third year as the head coach down there in Central Florida. They've gone from 22 wins to 34 wins last year, and now already 42 wins, and at bare minimum have clinched a spot at the play-in tournament, but they have certainly higher aspirations than that, as they're in the midst of a big homestand right now. And we'll keep you updated on the progress. Again, the NBA, look, it's coming down to the wire, man. Most teams have about 10 games left in the regular season. That's hard to believe. You know, the Orlando Magic fans compared to the fans here in Jacksonville with the Jaguars, both franchises were, let's be honest, both were awful for a long time. Orlando has been to the playoffs twice in the last 12 years, right? Jacksonville has been to the playoffs twice in the last, 17 years, I guess? I mean, something ridiculous like that. So there's a lot of correlation you can make between Orlando and Jacksonville, Jaguar fans and Magic fans. The cool thing is that I can kind of see it from both sides. Jaguar fans, you remained loyal. You remained there and supporting the team and frustrated when things weren't going well, and you still cared. Very similar in Orlando. as bad as it's been down there for the last decade plus, that arena has been sold out much more times than it has not been. They are very supportive of Orlando, and they are now reaping the benefits of all those losses and all those missed opportunities as now they have turned the corner. We thought we had turned the corner here in Jacksonville, and I guess we still have to an extent, but certainly you'd like to see Jacksonville do a little more with the nucleus they have. But young stars in Orlando, Paolo Banchero, Franz Wagner, young stars in Jacksonville, Trevor Lawrence, Josh Allen, Trayvon Walker. So I do like the parallel, and I know that when Orlando's good, they tend to get some fans up here in the Jacksonville area, which is certainly nice to see. Well, that'll just about do it. It has been a very busy Wednesday night edition of Hacker After Dark. We certainly appreciate you guys hanging out with us here on 1010XL and on 92.5 FM. We'll be back tomorrow night on a Thursday, and we will do it all over again beginning at 6 o'clock. Dylan Denmark was your producer tonight. Dylan, great job as always. I'm the hacker, Ryan Green. And again, Jacksonville, thank you for spending part of your Wednesday evening with us right here on 1010XL and on 92.5 FM.
How's Wingstop sound?